Yes, fine. We can start with the presentation. We can start with the session because it's already 4:05. So I think.
Yes, ma'am.
So thank you all once again. I sincerely thank the Nehru Planetarium and all of you. I can see a lot of students, some teachers also, a few of them from the last session and a few new ones. So a very good afternoon to one and all. And I'll start with my screen share. And I believe that most of you, because as of now you are in schools, so most of you must be born after 2000. 2005 ke baad hi shayad many of you would have born, must be born. So the disasters and the accidents that I'll be taking up today is precisely the ones that happened in the last century. That means in the 1900s to the 2100 years, in those years. And my you know, the whole idea of taking up those natural disasters is that you know the ones that are taking place off late. There was in Vizag, in a styrene plant, styrene is a polymer styrene is a monomer which is used in making various polymers. So a few months back in the Vizag, in a styrene plant, there was an accident, and there was another accident. You've heard about Fukushima disaster that happened in 2011. So these are the ones that you must be knowing, and you will read about them. But I would emphasize on the ones which happened which happened long back, and not because you may not be very well aware of them, but primarily because ye jo disasters the, ye jo problems hui, these problems laid the very foundations of well-placed regulations, well-placed policies. And you know, we learned from those disasters and those accidents that happened then to formulate, to regulate, and to have better systems, better policies, and better regulations for one and all. So it's very important, because past mein jo hua bachche, wo past ki cheezein hi hamare future ko improvise karne mein hame they help us. And in 1900s, and that period of time was that time when most of the discoveries and most new things discoveries were taking place, and new things were being found out. So us samay galti hone ke chances bahut zyada the aur galtiyan hui. Un galtiyon se seekh karke aaj humne ek base banaya hai. We have laid foundations for better systems, and that is why it is very important for you all to understand and to know that what these problems were. So Prerna, it still says host disabled yes, participant screen sharing.
I'll make you the host so that you can do the sharing and we can avoid the annotation thing. So ma'am, in a meanwhile, I think many people are still joining, so you just have
yes,
to
yes you please
we can start, because maybe they have seen the message late, so probably there is the possibility today that they might join little late.
Okay, so I'll keep admitting them.
Yes. This is you have to do today.
I'll do that. I'll do.
Yeah. So let's begin, ma'am. Now you can do the sharing.
Okay. So is the screen visible?
It's not yet, ma'am, but it's showing that you already shared the screen. So not the presentations appeared on the screen.
Says your screen sharing is paused. I don't know why.
It's gone, ma'am.
Yeah, it was telling me that it is paused. I'll read that.
Yeah, we can see that.
Yeah. So if it is visible, I'll start with my poem that we started from in the last class as well. And the poem is, Aao sune kahani, aaj meri zubani. Inme hai masti aur bahut sara gyan, aur ye lectures ki tarah tumhe nahi karenge pareshan. Inme un durghatnaon ka varnan hai, jinka rasayan vigyan se nata hai. इनको जानेंगे आज हम क्योंकि इतिहास जानकर ही भविष्य संवारा जाता है. जैसा मैंने आपको कहा कि इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर अस टू नो अबाउट आवर पास्ट बिकॉज ओनली बाय बिल्डिंग अप ऑन द फाउंडेशंस ऑफ द पास्ट वी कैन बिल्ड अप अ बेटर फ्यूचर. क्योंकि इतिहास जानकर ही भविष्य संवारा जाता है. लेंगे हम कुछ सीख भी और भविष्य अनुसंधान में सुधार लाएंगे. मानव जाति कल्याण हेतु अपना कदम उठाएंगे. तो आओ बच्चों सुने कहानी दुखद दुर्घटनाओं की और जाने कैसे इनसे बनी राह नई संभावनाओं की. कैसे ये दुर्घटनाएं और ये जो डिजास्टर्स थे कैसे इन्होंने एक नई राह बनाई नई संभावनाओं की नई पॉलिसीज की नई रेगुलेशंस की. तो आज हम उसके बारे में जानेंगे. सो द सीरीज लेक्चर 2 नेचुरल एंड मैन मेड केमिकल डिजास्टर्स. So the first one which I start with is the very famous or the very infamous rather the Hindenburg disaster. And now the Hindenburg disaster is the first disaster or the first accident in the commercial aviation history. अभी कुछ टाइम पहले कोझिकोड में देर वॉज अ एयर इंडिया प्लेन लैंडिंग फ्रॉम दुबई. इट वॉज वेरी मच इन द न्यूज एंड द प्लेन क्रैश्ड. दैट वॉज because you know it was a tabletop airport and etc etc. But commercial aviation history mein, in the history of flying, in the history of passenger flying flights, this was the first accident or the first this thing where casualties happened. And this happened on the 6th of May in 1937 at the Naval Air Station Lakehurst in New Jersey. Now what happened, actually before that I would like to tell you about zeppelins. So zeppelins are jo abhi hamari flights hai, they are all heavier than air, we all know that. But because they are made up of metal, you have aluminium as the main structure, so obviously these flights which are now flying, they are basically working on aerodynamics and they are heavier than air. But long back we had flights which were lighter than air because that was the only way hame lagta tha ki koi cheez ud sakti hai to wo sirf tabhi udegi jab wo air से लाइट हो. सो इन दोस डेज वी हैड लाइटर देन एयर शिप्स एंड सम ऑफ देम वर कॉल्ड ज़ेपेलिन्स. ज़ेपेलिन्स कम्स फ्रॉम द नेम ऑफ दिस जर्मन पर्सन. ही वाज अ नाजी, नाजी जर्मनी में ही वाज अ वेरी फेमस पर्सन हु डिजाइन्ड दीज शिप्स. हिज नेम वाज फर्डिनेंड वॉन ज़ेपेलिन एंड ऑन हिज नेम बिकॉज ही वाज द डिजाइनर ऑफ दीज शिप्स वर कॉल्ड ज़ेपेलिन्स. दे वर ह्यूज वंस, सम 800 900 फीट लॉन्ग शिप्स एंड प्रिसाइसली इनके अंदर हाइड्रोजन गैस फिल की जाती थी. एंड यू ऑल नो दैट हाइड्रोजन गैस बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स वेरी लो मॉलिक्यूलर मास It is lighter than air because air ka maximum composition is 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen. So air, nitrogen is obviously a heavier gas. Similarly, the case with oxygen, but hydrogen on the other hand was a very is in fact the lightest, is one of the lightest gases known. So this was used in World War One for observations and bombing. Nazi Germany mein World War One mein in flights ko use karte the for observation and for bombing. एंड लेटर ऑन 1936 के अराउंड इनको यूज करना शुरू किया गया फॉर फ्लाइट्स. सो देयर वर फ्लाइट्स दैट वर टेकिंग पीपल फ्रॉम जर्मनी टू अमेरिका इन जस्ट अ स्पैन ऑफ 2 to 3 डेज. वेल आई कम टू दैट. सो दीज वर कंसिडर्ड टू बी द टेरिफाइंग जायंट्स ऑफ द स्काई इन द अर्ली 20th सेंचुरी विच इज समवेयर अराउंड 1936 37 1930s का टाइम था. एंड दे वर यूज्ड इमेंसली इन बॉम्बिंग एंड इन ऑब्जर्वेशंस. लाइक आज के डेट में हम ड्रोन्स यूज करते हैं. सो दे वर यूज्ड एंड दे वर मेनली फिल्ड विद नाइट्रोजन, सॉरी फिल्ड विद हाइड्रोजन गैस. And the first accident, this one of the flights, one of the Zeppelin flight, which was called LZ-129, it is also called as the Titanic of the air. This is a screenshot from one of the reports, and it was called the Titanic of the air because this ship went through a massive explosion, and the explosion occurred because the ship was primarily made up of hydrogen gas, which is highly combustible. You all know कि हाइड्रोजन गैस जो है वो बहुत कंबसिबल होता है, तो हाइड्रोजन गैस के प्रेजेंस की वजह से दिस शिप यू नो इट अंडरवेंट इट कॉट फायर. एंड द रीजन व्हाई इट कॉट फायर वॉज नथिंग बट अ वेरी सिंपल रीजन ऑफ लाइटनिंग. देर वॉज लाइटनिंग इन द एटमोसफेयर, एंड सिंस हाइड्रोजन इज अ हाईली कंबसिबल गैस, इसमें मेनली हाइड्रोजन भरा हुआ था, तो हाइड्रोजन कॉट अप फायर एंड विद इन सेकेंड्स दिस 804 फीट लॉन्ग शिप जस्ट ब्लू इनटू पीसेस. एंड देयर वर 100 पीपल अबोर्ड द शिप, आउट ऑफ विच अराउंड 37 पीपल डाइड. So this was a very big disaster. First time people saw a ship going up in flames. 1937 mein aap socho, you know, it was a dreadful sight, and I will come to it. So Hindenburg was the last of the great airships, and you know, it was such an elite aircraft. जैसे मैंने आपको बताया, पहले इसको bombing के लिए use करते थे Nazi Germany में. And then after that, it was you know, it was put into use for commercial flights. So it was only the elite people, the rich people, who could afford. And you know, it was a very fun experience because Germany se America tak ka jo distance hai, these ships would be covering in just 2 to 3 days. So it was a wonderful experience. In fact, despite having only hydrogen in it, or hydrogen bhi main aapko batau isme kitna tha, it was somewhere around 7 million cubic cm cube. So that huge amount of hydrogen gas was filled into that ship. Aur uske bavajood, because elite people were traveling, iske andar, you know, they had a smoking chamber. So, you know, you could go inside that chamber and you could smoke, and still the ship would not caught fire because the pressure conditions were maintained such that hydrogen would not be able to enter the room where smoking was allowed. But, you know, and there were around 100 people aboard the ship. When while coming, and it was about to land, it was very close to New Jersey Naval Air Base ke paas ye aa chuka tha, and it was about to land, and lightning struck and the ship went up in flames and 37 people died because the gas which filled up this entire ship was hydrogen gas, which is highly inflammable.
Okay. So ma'am, many people are at the waiting room, so if you can allow them just quickly so that they can also be.
I can't see them. There isn't anyone in the waiting room,
right? I just got message from Shweta Bansal. She's saying her students are waiting.
Ma'am, Nikshubha might be waiting. Nikshubha Pandey.
Nikshubha ko to I allowed. I remember allowing a girl by the name Nikshubha.
Okay, ma'am. You may continue, ma'am. Sorry for the disturbance.
Then you can continue, ma'am. I think this message she sent it. I think 4:18 pe she has sent it. So probably I had read it late.
Yeah,
so
Nikshubha, are you here? Nikshubha, are you here?
Yes, ma'am, she is there. Okay. I can see her. Ma'am, you please continue. Sorry for interrupting.
No problem. Some problem with the, So, as I said, 36 or 37 lives were lost in the first casualties of commercial aviation history. And, you know, this was a little boy that who survived. And his name was Werner Donner. And, you know, he was on the ship with his family. Now he is no more. He died sometime back. But this is a report which was published in 2007, where, you know, they have the last survivor of Hindenburg disaster speaks on the eve of the 80th anniversary of the crash. And this little boy was an 8-year-old man then. He's no more now. But, you know, he talks about his memoirs. And he says that that his whole family had gone up on that ship, and they were on a vacation. When the ship started landing down, his father, he was a photographer, so he went out and he said that, you know, I'll be taking pictures of how the ship is landing. And he went out, and immediately there was lightning and the ship caught fire and everything went up in the flames. The mother was very prompt, and the mother immediately threw Werner, this little boy who was only 11 years old then, and his brother from the ship. She immediately threw them down so that if there is any possibility, they will survive. And she was trying to lift her daughter, because the daughter was apparently elder. So she was trying to lift her daughter, but she was unable to. And in the meanwhile, it was in such a fraction of second may the ship came down. It was into flames, and the mother, she broke her hip. Werner Donner has recalled that his elder brother was telling him that let us run to the hospital, but he was in no position to run. As you can see, he was extensively burned, his legs, his face, his mouth, and everything was burned. And eventually they never saw the father again. So the father and the daughter, both of them could not survive the accident. So the boy, in a very tragic description, he says that we had come on a vacation, but after the accident, all that we were attending was a cremation and funeral ceremony for his sister and for his father. So a very tragic incident. As you can say, Donner remembers that suddenly the air was on fire. He says that, you know, the entire air went up in flames, and the Hindenburg is something you don't forget. So this was an 800-foot long German passenger ship which caught fire at the Naval Air Station in New Jersey in 1937. And it was because an inferno, which is lightning, caught the hydrogen that filled up the ship into flames. And a very tragic image that was reported in the New York Daily on the next day, that is the 7th of May, 1937. And you can see, such a huge shot, because these are people all around it, and the people can barely be seen. And the entire ship was down, and it just went down. But what, the story, what we learned from this one, from the Hindenburg disaster was A, hydrogen just cannot be used. We realized that, these zeppelins, which were primarily made up of hydrogen, hum unko use nahi kar sakte. So that build up the road ki agar hame observations karni hai, aur agar hame, we want flights which are lighter than air, what can we do? And then walked in, which gas, tell me. Which gas do you think would have been a very good alternative?
Helium.
Yeah. Helium. And why? Tell me. I narrated a story about helium in the last episode. Does anyone remember that? It was a story about the Kansas state in America, where they had dug up a new oil field.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Can someone tell me that story?
No, because helium doesn't work.
Helium doesn't burn. But can anyone recall the story for me, for those who have joined today? Yeah, sure, please go ahead.
Ma'am, you had told that in Kansas, a person had found a small sort of canyon in which a gas was being released, which he thought was natural gas. But yes, when he tried to light it to see if it was flammable in front of a huge crowd of people, he was disappointed that it didn't burn, because it was helium and it was not natural gas.
Very good. Very good, Anuprabha. So, this was a story in Kansas state, and they had a huge gathering to have more and more people see that the state is about to be, matlab hum ameer hone wale hain, we are going to turn prosperous because we have a natural gas reservoir in our state. And a whole gathering was called up, and then, they tried to inflammate the gas which was being released. Or agar natural gas hota to immediately fire catch karta, जैसे हमारे सिलेंडर्स और इसमें नेचुरल गैस होते हैं, बट इट नेवर कॉट फायर बिकॉज़ अ मेजर कंपोनेंट ऑफ इट वाज हीलियम. सो हीलियम इज हाईली इन नॉन कंबसिबल, नॉट एट ऑल कंबसिबल, लाइटर देन एयर अगेन, एज यू नो अबाउट द हीलियम शिप्स, एज यू नो अबाउट द हीलियम बलून्स, एंड दैट इज व्हाई हीलियम appeared as, तब तक हीलियम की डिस्कवरी भी हो चुकी थी, सो हीलियम अपीयर्ड एज अ वेरी गुड If you remember, the discovery of helium happened somewhere in 1868 when there was a total solar eclipse in India. So helium offered a very good alternative, and people just went on with helium. I don't know why doesn't it go. It comes to ruk jata hai. The screen sharing just stops in between. Yeah, so before I get into that, this was a person, Herbert Morrison. And Herbert Morrison reported a very, he presented a very emotional report. He was the person who saw, who witnessed this accident live, and he was on radio. And, he immediately went emotional because he was seeing this ship falling down, and his words were, "Oh, the humanity." "Oh, the humanity" was the cry from the radio announcer Herbert Morrison, this fellow here. And it is one of the most famous audio reports ever filed, because it is very tragic to hear his voice and tragic to see the ship falling down. I would like to share my screen with a NatGeo NatGeo clipping of this. I don't know whether aapko dikhega ya nahin, but I would try at least to present that. Give me a minute. Just give me a minute.
Hello. Hello, am I audible? Hello.
Yeah, just a minute. Yes, got it. So is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, am I audible?
So I'll show you the...
Ma'am.
Yes, you are audible.
So I hope you saw that, and the person was none other than Herbert Morrison, who went emotional. If you can hear his voice, it was pretty emotional. Did you see that video, students? Were you able to see it?
Yes, ma'am.
So immediately helium acted as a better alternative, and the German airships were, you know, the Zeppelins were grounded by the World War II, because there were many episodes of more and more tragedies because of them. And helium, which had 93% of the lifting power of hydrogen, hydrogen jitna to acha nahi upar jata tha, but it, because obviously of the mass difference, but yes, it was as 93% as good as hydrogen with no fire danger at all. So this name Goodyear came up in the last episode also of my discussion. Charles Goodyear, if you remember, he was responsible. Yes, he was responsible for the vulcanization process. So Charles Goodyear ki company, he had established a company by the name of Goodyear that still manufactures a lot of tires these days. So Goodyear collaborated with America, and America became the state which was producing a lot of helium. So they said that, okay, in collaboration with America, we will build what is came to be called as, you know, the Goodyear blimps. And you know, the word blimps means something which is non-rigid. So is ye jo ship aap dekh rahe ho, these were called Goodyear blimps. They were not like Zeppelins, kyunki Zeppelin mein aapne dekha metallic framework bhi tha, but these ships, the Goodyear blimps, they do not have any metallic frame, they do not have any framework, they only have gas filled inside them, and you know, they emerged to a great advantage of the United States, because United States had gained monopoly on helium production. So I'll take up questions later, students. So they gained up monopoly in helium production, and later on it was the Goodyear blimps which was used in bombings by America, and which was also used in observations in the later on World War that happened. Before I get into that, I just wanted, because we're talking about chemistry, so I just wanted to tell you that the concept on which these lighter than air ships worked was nothing other than the Avogadro's law. Avogadro's law mein aapne kya padha? Aapne Avogadro's law mein padha ki chahe koi bhi gas ho aur uska koi bhi volume ho. कोई भी गैस हो, अगर आप उसका 1 mole गैस लेते हो, then that gas at 1 atmosphere and 273 Kelvin will take up a volume of 22.414 liters. उसका वेट में फर्क होगा, लेकिन the volume will remain the same. It's a very beautiful concept. If you imagine, if you take 3 balloons, as we have shown here, one filled with helium, the other filled with ammonia, and the other with oxygen, and you consider all the 3 gases, isme 22 liters agar tum gas bhar do teeno mein, isme tumne 22 liters helium bhara, isme tumne 22 liters ammonia bhara, aur isme tumne 22 liters oxygen bhara, then on the basis of Avogadro's law, although the volume of the 3 will be the same, they will be 22 liters, the size or the weight will be the least for the helium gas. So if someone ever asks you what is the concept behind the Avogadro's law, then behind the airships, the concept is nothing but the Avogadro's law. And as you have, I know there's a very interesting thing that I have written here.
Ma'am, your screen is not coming on the screen sharing. We can see your mail is open. So aap ek bar screen share apna kar dijiye.
Screen share kara hua tha. I think there is a problem with Zoom. Doesn't allow. Now is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. Now it is visible, because earlier when you played it, the National Geographic video, na, so after that your screen, the presentation screen was not coming on our screen. So we can't see that, but we heard the conversation which you are discussing about the law. No, so now we can see your screen.
Is it visible to everyone, all the students?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, fine. I'll take up the questions later. Let me just go through it quickly. So a cubic meter of air weighs, has 78% nitrogen and 21% oxygen, and it weighs more than a kilogram. But agar tum itna a cubic meter air ko replace kar do helium se, So, and you know, a certain percentage of hydrogen, and you do those calculations, it's a very interesting calculation where you will land up that the mass is so less that it will provide you a 1 kilogram lift. Agar ek gas hai, 1 meter cube ka, aur usme normal air hai, तो उसका जो वेट है और अगर एक चेंबर है 1 meter cube का उसमें हीलियम और हाइड्रोजन है तो उन दोनों के वेट में अराउंड 1 kilogram का फर्क होता है. सो इफ यू रिप्लेस अ चेंबर विद हाइड्रोजन एंड हीलियम इट ऑटोमेटिकली प्रोवाइड्स यू अ लिफ्ट ऑफ 1 kilogram अगेंस्ट नॉर्मल एयर. सो दैट इज व्हाई यू नो इट राइजेस. Anyway, so the geopolitical situation in the world was tensing up because United States passed a bill where they said that they will not be exporting any helium to any country in the world. In 1925, I believe they passed this law, and because the world war was about to happen, the situations were getting tense. So United States refused its export, and in 1925, through an act, they banned the export of helium to other countries because they said that let us be the superpower in helium. Agar hamare paas helium hai, hum Goodyear blimps banayenge, aur let other countries buy it from us, or let us use it for observations and bombing or for whatever we want to use it, but we won't export any helium to the other countries in the world. And you know, they started using helium before the World War II. They started using helium as a coolant in nuclear reactors. Most of you would have studied the chapter on radioactivity, and in the chapter on radioactivity, you know about coolants. So they started up with a project which was called Manhattan Project, and that is the next topic that I'll be taking up, where helium was used as a coolant in the nuclear reactors. In one of my previous lectures at the planetarium, I told why helium can act as a super cooled liquid, and because it can act as a super cooled liquid, it is used as a coolant in many operations. In fact, jo ye MRI scanners hote hain, जो हॉस्पिटल्स में those huge scanners, they are enveloped with a casing of helium, and they are also used. Helium is also used in nuclear reactors to cool. So apart from its non-combustible nature, it is also a super cooled. You know, it can be cooled to an extremely low temperature, still maintaining that phase, and hence it behaves as a coolant. And this is a very interesting photo. I particularly put it here because later on, aajkal to drone imaging or drone photography hoti hai, so we don't need something. But long back, whenever there used to be football matches or anything, it was these Goodyear blimps that were placed above these stadiums. They were filled with helium gas. They were placed above the stadium so that jo cameras hain, aerial shots le sake. You know, those goals and all could be captured through an aerial shot beautifully. And आप देखना, बहुत सारे इमेजेस हैं जिसमें यू विल सी दैट गुडियर ब्लिम्प्स आर अप इन द स्काई, एंड दे प्रोवाइडेड अ प्लेटफॉर्म, स्टेबल प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर पीपल टू पुट अप देयर ट्राइपॉड्स एंड पुट अप देयर कैमरास एंड टेक एरियल शॉट्स फॉर ऑल द मैचेस दैट आर टेकिंग प्लेस. सो दिस इज अ लाइन फ्रॉम अ बुक ऑन सेरेंडिपिटी, व्हिच इज अ वेरी ब्यूटीफुल लाइन, एंड दैट इज व्हाई आई पुट इट अप हियर. इट सेज दैट we can all be reminded of the unusual element that was discovered serendipitously on the sun, which is helium they're talking about, and later on Earth, whenever we see that Goodyear blimp. So whenever you see this Goodyear blimp, you recall helium, which was discovered accidentally in sun in a total solar eclipse that happened in India. When you see a Goodyear blimp hovering over a football stadium, which provides a magnificent platform for television cameras. So the next thing that I'll be talking about is the Manhattan Project, which I mentioned that US used helium in the Manhattan Project. Probably many of you would be familiar with it. If for those who aren't familiar, it was the project which was responsible for the development or for the manufacture of atomic bombs. And since we're talking about disasters, we cannot forget the nuclear bombings at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. I'll not get into its details because I believe you know it, but some key words which I think are important and that must be stressed is that the Manhattan Project, it was an R&D, it was a research and development undertaking of America, England and Canada to produce the first nuclear weapons in World War II. There was a letter written by Einstein, and he shared this letter with American President Franklin Roosevelt, where he said that, you know, the other countries of the world are building up a nuclear bomb, and you must also think on those lines. And it was after that letter, Einstein was criticized world over, that he wrote this letter to Roosevelt, who was the American president, that we must also start building up atomic bombs. But you know, this fellow, the Manhattan Project was still put up, and he was criticized. Einstein was heavily criticized all across the world for giving up this idea of setting up a Manhattan Project. Although the person who is considered to be the father of atomic bomb was another scientist by the name of Robert Oppenheimer. Anyway, so these are two interesting names, Little Boy and Fat Man, are actually the names of the atomic bombs which were dropped in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Because these are coded words, nobody used to call ki hum atomic bomb drop karne wale hain. So they always said that the little boy is on work. The little boy works very good. The fat man doesn't work very good, or whatever. So these were the nomenclatures which were used in the Manhattan Project to talk about the bombs that were built. And little boy was uranium 235. Again, nuclear fission reactions. Aapne padha hai. Which produce a lot of heat and uncontrollable. Agar ho jaye, boron rods dal ke aap usko control kar sakte ho, but if they go uncontrollable, then they explode. So uranium was the active nucleus which was used. 15 kilotons, matlab 15,000 ton. And it was dropped on Hiroshima on the 6th of August 1945, causing a casualty of around 1,50,000 people. 1.5 lakh log ke kareeb people died. And Fat Man was the name of the plutonium fission material which was dropped on Nagasaki 3 days later, on the 9th of August 1945, and causing a death of around 90,000 people. So that is about helium and this. Then I'll go to the next very important disaster, which was the thalidomide tragedy. Now, it's a very, ek aisi kahani jisne dunia mein drug approval systems ka naksha badal diya. Aur drug approval aur drug provide करने के लिए आपको एक बहुत ही rigorous protocol को follow करना पड़ेगा. For example, we are trying to develop a drug on COVID-19 or a vaccine, but we have a very rigorous protocol that we are following. You know, first to test it on a few people, then to test it on more number of people. ऐसा नहीं कि एक test हुआ और drug market में आ गया and you start selling it. And that happened after the thalidomide tragedy. Now, that happened after the thalidomide tragedy, which occurred in 1960s, where children were born with a problem which is called phycomelia. I don't know why is this person trying to enter again and again. Koi to waiting room mein hai nahi, fir bhi wo pop up karta hai bar bar. Anyway, so hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, phocomelia ek aisi problem tha, a genetic disorder, which happened in kids in 1960s, more pronounced in Germany and all. And these kids, they were born with this disorder. This disorder mein jo aapke limbs hain, the hands and the legs of the newborn babies were very close to the trunk. The trunk is the abdomen. So, abdomen se bilkul chipke hue haath, like, you know, hands are protruded and limbs are protruded, they're long, but the limbs and the hands were stunted. They were very close to the main abdomen or the trunk of the body. And a lot of mothers gave birth to children with this disorder. And what happened on the story goes something like this. You know, Prerna, what happens when a lot of people start coming in, then ye na mujhe move karne nahi deta aage. The screen share just stops.
Okay, but there are, I don't think there is anyone in the waiting room or...
Okay, so this is a picture of a kid, poor kid suffering from focomelia. And as you can see, the trunk is very close to the body. The hands do not, extend. The limbs are not as extended as they should be for any normal child. And the problem was that this was this drug which was called R-thalidomide. आप में से कई बच्चों ने R और S configurations chirality के बारे में पढ़ा होगा. And those who haven't studied will study it in your further classes. But chirality is a phenomenon where you have two things as mirror images of each other. तो आप ये compound सोचो और इसका आप अगर exact mirror image लो. This is a mirror, suppose. So you have another compound, but this is an S configuration and this is an R configuration. Now the two configurations were hugely different. Jo R configuration tha was the good part of the drug, and it was responsible for causing sleep. Ab 1960s ka jo time tha na bachcho, that was the post World War era. And in the post World War era, there was people had gone through a lot of stress in those years in their lives. So a lot of people used to be taking drugs, used to be taking medicines for sleep, and these sleep drugs were very commonly sold. बिल्कुल काउंटर पे आप जाओ, आपको नींद की दवाई मांगो और आपको इमीडिएटली नींद की दवाई दी जाती थी. बिकॉज अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल वेर इन द रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ दे वेर सफरिंग फ्रॉम स्ट्रेस, दे वेर सफरिंग फ्रॉम डिप्रेशन, द वर्ल्ड हैड कोलैप्स्ड, पीपल हैड नो होम्स, नो फूड, नो प्लेस टू लिव एंड नो मनी, नथिंग. सो देर वॉज अ लॉट ऑफ स्ट्रेस ओवरऑल, especially Germany or in countries mein who were rigorously involved in the world wars, there was a lot of stress. So these drugs, thalidomide appeared as a very interesting drug. ये drug जब आया market में तो लोग इतने खुश हुए because ये एक ऐसा drug था which was non-barbiturate. मतलब it was a sedative. Sedative मतलब जिससे आपको नींद आए. Sedation का मतलब होता है सुलाना, नींद लाना. So it was a sedative, but it did not have any barbituric effects. That means it never affected any, it did not adversely affect the central nervous system of your body. So this drug was a huge hit. It became a wonder drug, a wow drug. That, a drug, that is why I've written here, it was the safety of thalidomide, the only non-barbiturate sedative. And it was called a wonder drug. And it was such a good drug that doctors started giving it to mothers, pregnant women, expecting mothers, who complained of the feelings of nausea, vomiting, morning sickness and all. So whenever an expecting mother would go to a doctor with complaints of morning sickness or with complaints of vomiting tendencies during expectancy period, the doctors would say, advise thalidomide. And everybody was taking it very casually, very happily, all well so far. The problem was that at physiological pH, which is the pH in the body, this drug, which is the R configuration, which is sleep inducing, can convert to the S configuration at the pH in the human body. And the S configuration, as I have mentioned here, is teratogenic. Teratogenic ka matlab hai something. Teratogenology is a study jahan pe aap stunted limbs, stunted haath pair ko study karte ho, and where the body, where as I told you, the limbs are very, very close to the trunk of the body. So this was the S configuration was the bad part of the drug, which was a teratogenic. And the famous names under which this drug was sold was called Contergan. Germany mein especially Contergan, Distavel. This is a very interesting image of a mother holding a baby, and Distavel was prescribed to mothers, and thalidomide tablets. And as Distavel ka jo wo tha uspe, the British Medical Journal, it approved it saying that it is safe sedation and sounder sleep, non-barbituric, sedative and hypnotic. A wonderful drug. What happened was this. Some very sorry pictures of children who were born with such deformities, with their legs and their limbs stunted, or achanak se jab across Germany and Europe, a lot of cases of this type were started appearing. People thought, kya hua, kya hua, kya hua, and people started finding out what went wrong, what did the mothers take, was it a genetic disorder or was it a non-genetic disorder, and ultimately the blame came to thalidomide. And so much so that some newspaper clippings are thalidomide children, a cause for national shame. And there was this company which was called Grünenthal. This was a German firm which had made this medicine. And around 10,000 babies were born which were affected by thalidomide. In fact, 2011 tak 3,000 usme se abhi bhi jinda the bacche. Matlab, obviously they have grown up, but they still have that disorder. Their limbs don't function. They have these problems and they need a lot of care. Sirf ek drug ki wajah se jo unki mothers ne liya, unknowingly liya because unko doctors ne prescribe kiya, and those children who have aged up today, they are suffering and there's no one to look at them. And Grünenthal had to pay huge amount of penalties to the people and to the sufferers of this disease. But ab aaj ki date mein bhi these people are suffering. They need a lot of care and they need a lot of attention. ये जो पूरी कहानी है इसने ड्रग अप्रूवल सिस्टम्स का पूरा सिनारियो बदल दिया. इस कहानी से लोगों को ये रियलाइज हुआ कि कोई भी ड्रग यूं ही मार्केट में नहीं आना चाहिए, और एक ड्रग को मार्केट में लाने से पहले उसके बहुत स्तरों पर आपको उसकी जांच और आपको उसके प्रभाव या दुष्प्रभाव देखने पड़ेंगे ऑन द पीपल हु आर गोइंग टू बी इट्स रेसिपिएंट्स. I got this from internet, which is a thalidomide trust which has come up, and the thalidomide trust, as it says, is currently supporting around 500 beneficiaries in the age of 55 to 61. आप ये सोचो जो 1960 के दशक में बच्चे पैदा हुए वो बच्चे आज की डेट में अराउंड 60 साल के होंगे. मतलब वो लोग आज की डेट में अराउंड इट्स अराउंड 60 years after 1960, so they must be around 60 years of age. So these people are being aided still. And it's a very nice line which says, if you believe that you were damaged by your mother taking thalidomide, then during her pregnancy, you please contact this trust. So they are a very generous trust which has come up and in the action of helping people who suffer from this disease. And as a result of this, rigorous drug approval and monitoring systems were placed in United States Food and Drug Administration. और आज हम कहते हैं कि कोई भी ड्रग है उसको एटलीस्ट 4 फेज ट्रायल्स से गुजरना पड़ता है, which we call as the clinical trials of a drug. So ना सबसे पहले प्री क्लिनिकल होता है, वेर यू जस्ट टेस्ट इट इन विट्रो आउटसाइड बॉडी आउटसाइड एनी लिविंग टिश्यू. देन यू टेस्ट इट on organisms. Then you bring it into the phase 1. Abhi aap kaafi sun bhi rahe hoge news mein, where you give it to a few number of participants. Then it goes to phase 2, then phase 3, then FDA does a review, and then finally phase 4. Aur jab koi drug in charo phases se pass ho jaye, then finally it is given, it is it comes out in the market as a proper drug which is ready to be used, and thanks to the sorry state of thalidomide. The next is nerve agents. I'll quickly go into it because nerve agents were again used in World War, and these are nerve agents. Ka naam nerve agents isliye hai because they target the central nervous system. और सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम का मेन फंक्शन आपकी बॉडी में क्या है? टू सेंड मैसेजेस फ्रॉम वन ऑर्गन टू द अदर ऑर्गन एंड टू रन योर टू कीप योर बॉडी फंक्शनल. अब जो ये नर्व इम्पल्सेस ट्रांसफर होते हैं, इफ एनी ऑफ यू आर इन द हायर क्लासेस एंड डूइंग बायोलॉजी, देन यू नो दैट देयर आर सिनेप्सिस बिटवीन द एंड इट इज थ्रू दीस सिनेप्सिस इन बिटवीन दीस सिनेप्सिस वी हैव एन एंजाइम व्हिच इज कॉल्ड एसिटाइल कोलीन एस्टरेज. Okay, the enzyme is called acetylcholine esterase, and it is this enzyme which is responsible for the transmission of nerve impulses from one neuron to the other neuron. तो जो ये नर्व एजेंट्स थे और ये अगेन देवर यूज इन वर्ल्ड वॉर, द नेम्स आर ताबून विच वॉज कॉल्ड जी ए, सरीन विच इज दिस इज द स्ट्रक्चर विच इज कॉल्ड जी बी, सोमान विच इज कॉल्ड जी डी, एंड साइक्लोसरीन विच वॉज शॉर्ट फॉर्म्ड एज जी एफ, एंड द फुल नेम्स आर ऑल्सो गिवन हियर, इथाइल डाइमिथाइल फॉस्फोरामाइड साइनो cyanidate. So these compounds, they are basically organophosphorus compounds. Organophosphorus means they have a carbon and a phosphorus bond. So and all these organophosphorus compounds, they are known for attacking the acetylcholine esterase enzyme. तो आपने आपने बेगोन स्प्रे देखा है ना, घर में हिट स्प्रे देखा है, दे अगर आप उसकी कभी इंग्रीडियंट्स पढ़ोगे तो यू विल सी कि उसमें भी organophosphorus compounds होते हैं. तो when you spray it on a cockroach or on a mosquito, there you will see that they start, you know, twitching, and then they die. So that twitching effect comes because you know it attacks the central nervous system, and जब central nervous system attack होगा तो your limb movement, your hand movement, your entire nerve impulse transmission in the body will be completely disfigured, disoriented. तो उसकी वजह से तो ये आपको यू नो पीपल स्टार्ट यू नो इट अटैक्स देयर नर्वस सिस्टम एंड इवेंचुअली लीडिंग टू पैरालिसिस. तो ये जो केमिकल वॉरफेयर एजेंट्स हैं ये प्राइमरली वर्ल्ड वॉर टू के टाइम पे डिस्कवर किए गए और ये यू नो देवर यूज्ड. You can see taboon was synthesized in 36 and it is lethal. This one serine was in 38, again lethal. 1944 lethal, and cycloserine in 1945 lethal. And you know 350 people, 300 people, 1700 people, and 4000 people killed with the use of these nerve agents. They were paralyzed. In fact, detention homes mein to ye spray kar diya jata tha ki you know all the refugees or the detention camps mein jo log the, they would just paralyze and they would die. So such a tragic history. ये मैंने यहाँ पे देखो, इफ इट इज विजिबल टू यू, इट सेज इट इनहिबिट्स द ब्रेकडाउन ऑफ एसिटाइल कोलीन, क्योंकि एसिटाइल कोलीन एस्टरेज एंजाइम पे डायरेक्ट अटैक करते हैं. जब एंजाइम पे अटैक होता है तो नर्व इम्पल्स ट्रांसमिट नहीं होंगे. जब नर्व इम्पल्स ट्रांसमिट नहीं होंगे, इफ योर ब्रेन सेज मूव योर हैंड विल नॉट बी एबल टू मूव बिकॉज द नर्व फ्रॉम द इम्पल्स फ्रॉम द ब्रेन इज नॉट रीचिंग योर हैंड्स. इफ योर ब्रेन सेज यू नो आई हैव टू स्टेप बैक, यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू स्टेप बैक because the impulse from your brain is not getting transmitted to your body. So that is, and that is what, that is paralysis. So this causes paralysis. So it caused a lot of you know contraction of pupils, bronchodilations hue logon ko, and coma and eventual death. So a very sorry state, you know. It was used mainly again by Germany, and it was these were considered as weapons of mass destruction. In fact, people today also fear that many countries might be having or might have in possession these chemical warfare agents. And you know, you don't have to actually do anything. You just have to spray, and an entire race or an entire population can be killed because they're such strong nerve agents. And the next one which I would go to is the Minamata disease, which was an ugly kahani hai methyl mercury poisoning ki, that happened in Japan in 1956. And again a very you know a very sorry story. A story ye hai, par story mein jaane se pehle main aapko mercury ke bare mein batana chahungi. Hum sabko pata hai mercury poisonous hai. Mercury is a toxic metal, it is a heavy metal, we all know that, we've read over and over again. But mercury can exist in various forms. Now which form of mercury is the most toxic, or which of it is the most poisonous? Mercury can exist as normal mercury metal jo thermometers mein hai. Mercury can exist in the form of its salt like mercurous chloride, mercury chloride, and these are inorganic salts, HgCl2 or Hg2Cl2, these are inorganic salts. And mercury can also exist as alkyl mercury, which is methyl mercury, matlab CH3Hg. अब जहां पे भी कार्बन और मर्करी का एक बॉन्ड हो गया उसको हम बोलेंगे ऑर्गेनो मर्करिक कंपाउंड. जैसे मैंने आपको बोला ऑर्गेनो फॉस्फोरस मतलब कार्बन और फॉस्फोरस का बॉन्ड, वैसे ही ऑर्गेनो मर्करी इज अ बॉन्ड बिटवीन कार्बन एंड मर्करी. तो जो ये तीन फॉर्म्स है मरकरी के बच्चों जो मैंने यहाँ दिखाया है, यू हैव एन एलिमेंटल मरकरी, यू हैव अ इनऑर्गेनिक मरकरी एंड यू हैव एन ऑर्गेनिक मरकरी. द मोस्ट डेंजरस इज द ऑर्गेनिक मरकरी. द मोस्ट डेंजरस बिकॉज वाई आई विल कम टू इट. पर ये इतना डेंजरस है, और इतना डेंजरस इसलिए है क्योंकि ये आपके टिश्यूज को परकोलेट कर सकता है, ये मदर के प्लेसेंटा से फीटस में भी जा सकता है, एंड इट कैन पेनिट्रेट इन ऑल टिश्यूज ऑफ योर बॉडी डिस्पाइट बीइंग डिस्पाइट हैविंग अ मेटल लाइक मर्करी विच इज हेवी एंड टॉक्सिक. इस कंपाउंड की लिपोफिलिसिटी इतनी ज्यादा होती है कि ये इमीडिएटली आपके किसी भी सेल के अंदर घुस सकता है. इट कैन पेनिट्रेट थ्रू योर गैस्ट्रो इंटेस्टाइनल लाइनिंग्स, इट कैन बी अब्सॉर्ब्ड इन द लिवर, किडनी एंड हार्ट्स, एंड इट कैन ऑल्सो बी अब्सॉर्ब्ड बाय अ ग्रोइंग फीटस. Why is it so? Because, you know, there is an amino acid in our body which is cysteine, or agar and there is another amino acid which is methionine. Both of them are important. पर अगर सिस्टीन पे मिथाइल मरकरी का अटैक हो जाए, ये ब्लू डॉट्स, ये जो स्काई ब्लू वाला डॉट है ये मरकरी है, एंड दिस इज सी एच थ्री कार्बन हाइड्रोजन हाइड्रोजन हाइड्रोजन. सो अगर मिथाइल मरकरी सिस्टीन में घुस गया ना, तो वो इस टाइप का एक बॉन्ड बना लेता है. मतलब सल्फर, ये सल्फर है तुम्हारा, सिस्टीन का सल्फर. मैंने लास्ट टाइम बताया था हमारे बालों में भी सिस्टीन होता है जिसमें सल्फर सल्फर बॉन्डिंग होती है. तो ये सिस्टीन का सल्फर और ये मरकरी. सो देयर इज अ मरकरी सल्फर बॉन्ड. हार्ड एसिड सॉफ्ट बेस का कॉन्सेप्ट लगाना यहाँ पे. मरकरी एंड सल्फर फॉर्म अ गुड बॉन्डिंग. सो मरकरी एंड सल्फर एंड मिथाइल मरकरी आके सिस्टीन के साथ लग गया. अब जो ये स्ट्रक्चर बना विच इज सिस्टीन मिथाइल मरकरी, ये स्ट्रक्चर बहुत हद तक मेथियोनिन जैसा दिखता है. मेथियोनिन में यहाँ पर तुम्हारे पास ये लिंकेज है, और यहाँ पे यू हैव अ सल्फर लिंकेज. देर इज ओनली अ वेरी स्मॉल डिफरेंस बिटवीन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ मेथियोनिन एंड द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ सिस्टीन मिथाइल मरकरी, एंड द बॉडी कैनॉट डिस्टिंग्विश बिटवीन देम. तो बॉडी, अगर मिथाइल मरकरी का अटैक हो जाए तो बॉडी को लगता है इट इज समथिंग सिमिलर टू मेथियोनिन, एंड द बॉडी अलाउज इट, इट डजंट शो एनी प्रॉब्लम. एंड दैट इज व्हाई मिथाइल मरकरी सबसे डेंजरस फॉर्म है मरकरी का. अब कहानी क्या थी कि जापान में there was a factory which was called the Chiso factory. The Chiso factory was one of the biggest chemical factories in Japan, and this factory it was producing a lot of chemicals like acetaldehyde, you know, acetylene, octanol, bahut sare chemicals banata tha. It was matlab chemical industries ka maharaja keh sakte ho before the world war time in Japan. And you know, I'll go into the timeline first. So a very established factory and a very advanced factory, and it was majorly producing fertilizers, acetylene, acetaldehyde, vinyl chloride, octanol. Acetaldehyde bahut zyada ye produce kar rahe the, around 6000 ton एक साल में. और ये इतना acetaldehyde इसलिए produce कर रहे थे क्योंकि polymerization में acetaldehyde acetaldehyde is a raw material in the polymerization process. जब आप polyvinyl chloride produce करते हो तो acetaldehyde is a raw material for octanol production. तो octanol बनाने के लिए acetaldehyde चाहिए. octanol क्यों चाहिए? PVC बनाने के लिए. PVC के लिए octanol, octanol के लिए acetaldehyde. तो ये क्या कर रहे थे चीजों वाले, ये बहुत सारा acetaldehyde produce कर रहे थे. Now when you produce acetaldehyde from acetylene, you use a catalyst which is mercury. For that production is it is catalyzed by the use of mercury, and mercury, methyl mercury comes out as a byproduct. So I have shown this. जब आप acetylene से acetaldehyde बनाते हो तो आप mercury का catalyst use करते हो, और इस process में जो byproduct बनता है वो क्या बनता है? Methyl mercury, which is CH3HG. तो हुआ क्या, ये जो मीना माटा केस है, दिस केस इज अ वेरी गुड एग्जांपल ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियल पोल्यूशन, मरीन पोल्यूशन, एनवायरमेंटल पोल्यूशन एंड द कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ बायो मैग्निफिकेशन. और इसके सिम्टम्स क्या थे, डिफिकल्टी वॉकिंग, एटैक्सिया एंड नंबनेस. बट हुआ क्या वो आप समझो, तो ये चिसो फैक्ट्री एसिटाल्डिहाइड बना रही थी और मिथाइल मरकरी रिलीज कर रहे थे एज अ बाय प्रोडक्ट विच वॉज थ्रोन आउट इन द मीना माटा बे. Since there was a sea very close to it, तो यहाँ से जो भी effluents निकलते थे वो सारा इस bay में जाता था. And Japanese are seafood loving people, so they were the people in this area, in the Minamata city, in Kumamoto region and all, they were mainly dependent, especially the fishery people, जो मछुआरे थे वो बहुत ज्यादा हद तक निर्भर थे ये जो मछलियाँ ये bay में से निकालते थे as their food. So you know what happened, methyl mercury from the industrial effluent went into the planktons, planktons se wo fishes mein aaye, fishes se wo aur badi machliyon mein aaye, and these fishes were taken up by the local people as their food items. So in fact, जब food web में आप ऊपर जाते हो तो जो elemental concentration है वो increase होती जाती है, which we call as biomagnification. So what happened, the people of that area in 1956, एक छोटी सी बच्ची complained of numbness in her feet. She had difficulty in walking, she had difficulty in talking, and she started getting paralytic attacks. Numbness aa gayi, convulsions, chakkar aane lagi, ataxia, and sleep walking and sleep speaking difficulty. And as I've shown here, April May, a 5-year-old girl was hospitalized with symptoms of a disease that affected the central nervous system. किसी को समझ नहीं आया ये हो क्या रहा है. एक जापान यूनिवर्सिटी में, कुमामोटो यूनिवर्सिटी की एक रिसर्च टीम बनाई गई, क्योंकि द डॉक्टर्स डिड नॉट हैव एनी आइडिया कि ये बीमारी कौन सी है. तो उन्होंने बोला कि ये कोई स्ट्रेंज बीमारी है जिसकी वजह से ऐसा हो रहा है लोगों को. एंड नॉट ओनली दिस गर्ल, कुछ एक दो दिनों के बाद और भी लोग, और भी बच्चे हॉस्पिटलाइज होने लगे. अ कमिटी वॉज कॉन्स्टिट्यूटेड and this committee was constituted to find out ki kya problem hai. Bahut time tak ye committee lagi rahi dhoondne mein. Finally inhone ye identify kiya ki ye jo problem aa rahi hai ye zyadatar machhuaron mein aa rahi hai, people who are belonging to the fishery community. So they went into their homes and they asked them what have they been eating, what is it, and all of them said that they were eating shellfishes and fishes that were fished from the Minamata Bay. फिर उन फिशेस को लिया गया और उनकी स्टडी करी गई. एंड इट वाज इन नवंबर ऑफ 1956, अप्रैल में पहला केस रिपोर्ट हुआ और अप्रैल से नवंबर हो गया. और तुम्हें पता है कितना मरकरी था, अराउंड 705 पार्ट्स पर मिलियन, व्हेन द अलाउड इज ओनली 0.4. And the amount of mercury that was present was around 705 ppm. And all these fishes had lots of mercury in their body. Unke mercury se human body mein mercury aaya aur magnify ho gaya uska content. And you know, it methyl mercury came planktons mein aaya, planktons se bio accumulate hoke fishes mein, choti machliyon se badi mein, aur uske baad food mein. And then people started suffering from this disease. Especially in the Kumamoto region, around 17,000 people were declared as the victims of the Minamata disease. It was called the Minamata disease. And Chiso company jo thi, us company ko finally 1973 mein ek compensation declare karna pada to all the people, and 16 to 18 million yen were paid to the certified patients for as a compensation from this country, from this disease. This is the signing of that of the Chiso of the agreement between the family members, and this where the officials give money. Aur ye maine jo aapko numbness aur uski baat boli, so these are some very sorry and disturbing images of this. And the last one, Prerna, do I have time or shall I stop here?
No ma'am, you have time, please complete it.
Okay, so the last one is the Chernobyl nuclear disaster, which happened in Ukraine, Belarus specifically, or in 1986. एंड इट वॉज प्रिसाइसली यूरेनियम कोर का रिएक्टर था चेरनोबिल, आपने नाम शायद सुना हो. ये एक न्यूक्लियर एक्सीडेंट था और न्यूक्लियर एक्सीडेंट्स की ना एक कैटेगरी, जैसे रिक्टर स्केल पे अर्थक्वेक्स की कैटेगरी होती है ना, वैसे ही न्यूक्लियर एक्सीडेंट्स की कैटेगरी होती है. एंड दिस एक्सीडेंट बिलोंग टू द लेवल 7, सो इट वाज कंसिडर्ड टू बी अ वेरी इंपैक्टफुल न्यूक्लियर एक्सीडेंट. जो फुकुशिमा दाइची एक्सीडेंट हुआ था इन 2011 ऑल्सो बिलोंग्स टू अ लेवल ऑफ 11. सो फुकुशिमा एंड चेरनोबिल आर कंसिडर्ड टू बी द टू मोस्ट disastrous or tragic nuclear disasters of all times, and God forbid, we hope that we do not have any more. But this was in 1986 in Ukraine, which was then a part of USSR. तब रशिया का डिविजन नहीं हुआ था, so it was then a part of USSR. And the primary reason for this disaster was that the core got overheated. ये दो गलतियों की वजह से था. एक तो जो पर्सनल थे, जो लोग उसको ऑपरेट कर रहे थे, they were not adequately trained. And the second thing was कि जो रिएक्टर का डिजाइन था वो फ्लॉड था. आपको पता है कि किसी भी रिएक्टर में फिशन रिएक्शन को कंट्रोल में रखने के लिए कंट्रोल रॉड्स डालते हैं, विच आर बेसिकली बोरॉन और ग्रेफाइट रॉड्स. सो गलती से जो बोरॉन और ग्रेफाइट रॉड्स थे वो बाहर आ गए थे बिकॉज ऑफ सम फ्लॉड डिजाइन, एंड द चेन रिएक्शन वेंट uncontrollable, and so uncontrollable that the entire reactor, Chernobyl mein char nuclear reactors the 1, 2, 3, and 4, so it was the fourth reactor which just burst. मतलब थर्मल एनर्जी से वो फटा, पर जब वो फटा तो 150 टन रेडियो एक्टिव मटीरियल वॉज लिबरेटेड इन टू द एयर. इमेजिन 150 टन्स ऑफ एक्टिव यूरेनियम लिबरेटेड इन टू द एयर. बेलारूस और सब तरफ ये फैल गया. जो इससे आग लगी थी ना, वो आग 10 दिनों तक चलती रही थी, एंड इट वॉज नॉट कॉम्बैटेड. एंड यू नो हाउ वॉज दिस स्टॉप, दिस हाउ वॉज इसको कंट्रोल कैसे किया गया, हेलीकॉप्टर से कितने टन्स एंड टन्स ऑफ बोरॉन एंड ग्रेफाइट वेर ड्रॉप्ड इनटू द रिएक्टर थ्रू अ हेलीकॉप्टर, सो दैट द चेन रिएक्शन इज ब्रॉट अंडर कंट्रोल. बिकॉज अदरवाइज इसके पास तो जा नहीं सकते थे, रेडियो एक्टिव मटीरियल था, एक्सप्लोड कर रहा था और फायर बहुत तेज थी और आपको रोकना इसको जरूर था. सो द ओनली वे वॉज टू ड्रॉप यूरेनियम, सो टू ड्रॉप बोरॉन इन टू इट फ्रॉम यू नो फ्रॉम द एयर. एंड इसमें काफी लोगों की डेथ्स हुई बिकॉज ऑफ थायरॉयड कैंसर. अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल इनहेल्ड दैट मटीरियल. काफी दिनों तक बेलारूस और यूक्रेन का सारा एरिया खाली करवाया गया एंड नोबडी वॉज अलाउड टू स्टे इन दैट एरिया. स्टिल हुएवर इनहेल्ड द यूरेनियम मटीरियल, दे ऑल सफर्ड फ्रॉम थायरॉयड कैंसर. एंड यू नो जो इमीडिएट इम्पैक्ट था, उस इमीडिएट इम्पैक्ट से दो लोग तो ऑन द स्पॉट मर गए थे. सो चेरनोबिल इज अ वेरी वेरी डिजास्ट्रस एक्सीडेंट, एंड देर इज अ वीडियो विच आई वुड लाइक टू शो यू पर्टेनिंग टू चेरनोबिल. एंड जस्ट द लास्ट थिंग इन द डिस्कशन इज द वीडियो. Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am. We can see the link.
Can't you see the YouTube?
No, ma'am. We still can see your presentation, the YouTube link which was pasted on the last screen.
Okay. Just a second. दिख रहा है?
यस मैम.
यस मैम.
Ma'am, there is no audio in this clip. We can only see the visual coming on the screen.
There's no audio?
No, ma'am.
I think it's a problem with Zoom. I am not sure because...
Ma'am, you can also share the computer audio. The option comes, ma'am, while you're sharing.
Okay, let me see. Can you tell me where does the option come? Because I'm not very using.
Ma'am, when you click on the share option, ma'am, there's... ma'am, I think in below... ma'am, sabse niche, ma'am, you can find the option, ma'am. Share computer audio. If you can see it.
Yes, yes. I'll try now. If
If you click on share computer.
I did that. Yes, ma'am. I did that. That. More mein jaake, I've said share computer sound. I think it should be visible now. Ab batana.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We can.
The world's worst civilian nuclear disaster took place when a reactor exploded at the Chernobyl power plant in Ukraine, then part of the Soviet Union. Present-day Belarus received 60% of the initial fallout. The radioactive cloud spread further to cover most of Europe. The Chernobyl nuclear power plant was one of the Soviet Union's most advanced facilities. The first two reactors became operational in the late 1970s. The fourth reactor was the newest, going online in 1983. On April 26, 1986, technicians prepared to test the backup cooling system in reactor number 4. But the routine safety drill went horribly wrong. A nuclear reactor is like a giant steam engine. Uranium fuel rods react to produce a massive amount of heat. That converts water into steam, which drives huge turbines to generate electricity. Control rods are inserted in between the uranium to slow the reaction. And it's crucial for cooling water to be pumped around the core to prevent overheating. But as the test began, almost all of the control rods were removed, and technicians lost control of the flow of coolant. Temperatures soared, and extreme heat began to melt the core. At 1:23 a.m., reactor 4 exploded. It spewed 8 tons of radioactive debris into the atmosphere. 115,000 people were evacuated from a 30-kilometer zone around the plant. The battle to put out the fires inside lasted for 15 days. More than 500,000 military and civilian personnel were drafted to deal with the accident and its aftermath. 31 of the initial firefighters and plant workers died within days from acute radiation sickness. The toxicity of the radioactive cloud was equivalent to 400 Hiroshima atomic bomb explosions. Crews hastily built a concrete sarcophagus to encase the entire reactor to prevent more radiation from spreading. Inside, there remained 200 tons of radioactive fuel. The remaining three reactors continued to operate due to energy shortages in Ukraine. It wasn't until the year 2000 that the Chernobyl complex was completely shut down. With the concrete sarcophagus crumbling, the international community began to build a new confinement structure for Reactor 4. It stands 110 meters tall, higher than the Statue of Liberty, and it's wide enough to fit a ship the size of the Titanic. At a projected cost of $3 billion, construction is scheduled for completion in 2017. One of Chernobyl's iconic red and white chimneys will be dismantled, and the massive steel dome will slide over reactor number 4. The confinement structure is expected to last for at least 100 years.
So did you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, did you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
So the reactor exploded aur Hiroshima mein jitna tha uske 40 times zyada isme there was
On April 26, 1986, the Soviet Union's Chernobyl power complex nuclear reactor 4 exploded. The explosion was caused by major fundamental flaws.
This is a photo from Nat Geographic, and which says the cleanup site continued for decades and many parts became uninhabitable. And the last but not the least is the Bhopal gas tragedy, which we all know about. December 1984 in India, the company was Union Carbide India Limited, and the gas responsible was MIC, which is known as methyl isocyanide. And this is a very tragic image, which was published in India Today. Bhopal, this image, kai bari aise bhi quiz competitions mein poochte hain, you know, this image is related to what? And ye itna sorry image, itni disturbing image of a baby who died in the Bhopal gas tragedy when there was a methyl isocyanide. And isocyanide, again, as I told you, cyanides and isocyanides are extremely harmful. So there was a leakage in the Bhopal gas factory. People are still fighting for their rights, for their claims. And, you know, so many people lost their lives. They were paralyzed and so on and so forth. And the case is still going on. With that, I would like to conclude with a few other tragedies, but I don't have enough time to talk about it. Fukushima, you all heard that happened in Japan. And then if you find time, you do read about DDT and the thinning of eggs of bald eagle. Ye ek bahut interesting case hai jahan pe bald eagle is a raptor whose eggs ki jo lining thi wo bahut thin hoti gayi because a lot of DDT was sprayed in America. And uski wajah se iske jo bald eagle ke jo babies hai, jo juveniles hai, wo hatch hone se pehle hi mar jate the. And the population of bald eagle severely decreased. So environment pe DDT ka bahut severe impact hua tha, jiske baad America mein they stopped using DDT. And an interesting case of cadmium poisoning again in Japan is called the Itai Itai disease, or it is also called the Ouch Ouch disease, because Ouch Ouch Itai Itai ka matlab hota hai, it hurts. So this was a very painful disease which was caused by cadmium poisoning, and again cadmium poisoning through marine this thing. So some other important tragedies or episodes that you must know about. And with that, I would like to thank you all. This is my phone number, my email ID, official email ID, and my personal email ID. If at all you wish to communicate with me, ask any questions, you're free to note the email IDs. That's my mobile number. So you can also drop me a question or anything that you wish for further reference. And with that, I'd like to thank Nehru Planetarium once again. All you students, once again, Dr. Ratnashri and Prerna, for being so kind and so overwhelmingly supportive. Thank you all. Thank you all so much. I also have a quiz that I have prepared. It's not a Google form like last time. It's just a quiz. We can discuss if at all we have time, if Prerna says so. Yes. Otherwise, we can conclude.
No, ma'am. We definitely would like to do a quiz because kids are also... would like to participate in that manner. And obviously the session is open if anyone wants to ask something or have some related queries regarding the session. They are most welcome to ask. So they can open their mic and ask the question. Or a ma'am can start the quiz. Meanwhile, if something pops up then in their mind, so they can also ask.
Yes, yes. There are some students who said they could not see my screen. So, okay, I will show you the...
No, ma'am, that was earlier when I asked. Achha. You. No, that time your screen was not visible.
Okay, okay. So, is it now visible, the quiz?
Yes,
students, please turn on your mics.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, please turn on your mic. Shall we start?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All set?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, before that, how did you find the stories today? And
they were brilliant.
Very sad.
Not
very interesting and very
informative. Explained by you, brilliant, but stories were very tragic.
Yeah.
And they were so sad that they could only be made interesting in the most possible way which you did.
Yes, they were very sad. That's right. They were very sad. Somebody said not very interesting. Did I hear that? Somebody saying not very interesting? You can. You are free to share.
No, ma'am. You are informative.
I'm informative.
Okay. So I'll start with the quiz. Just a quick quiz, and let us see how well you know. And एकदम से बोल सकते हो जिसको आए पहले वो बोल सकता है. Okay, so the first question is, how long, approximately how long was Hindenburg?
800 feet.
Mam, 800 feet.
800 feet.
Good. Next, how long did the airship trip from Germany to America usually take?
Mam, 3 days.
3 days.
Very good. Yeah. In what year of 1930s? Exactly.
1937.
Very good. Very good. In what U.S. state did the Hindenburg crash take place?
New Jersey.
Okay. Lake. It was a naval air base in New Jersey. Approximately how many people were on board?
100.
Yeah.
And how many died?
36, 37.
Yeah, that's a rough figure. Who was the emotional radio broadcaster?
Herbert Morrison.
That's correct. What do the experts cite as the cause?
Lightning.
Okay. How many people were killed? We've already discussed. Okay. Goodyear blimps with filled with?
Helium gas.
Zeppelins.
Hydrogen gas.
You know the difference between zeppelins and blimps, right? Okay, next one. What was the name of the secret project of US to develop an atomic bomb?
The Manhattan Project.
Very good. Which Japanese city the atomic bomb was dropped?
Hiroshima, Japan.
पहले कहाँ ड्रॉप हुआ था, हिरोशिमा या नागासाकी?
मैम, हिरोशिमा नागासाकी में हुआ था.
हाँ, 3 दिन बाद नागासाकी में हुआ था.
मैम,
निकनेम ऑफ द बॉम्ब ड्रॉप्ड इन नागासाकी?
फैटमैन.
व्हाट वाज द रेडियो न्यूक्लियस इन इट?
प्लूटोनियम.
इज राइट. Okay, which scientist wrote a letter? ये मैंने presentation में नीता पर मैंने बोला था. Who wrote a letter?
Albert Einstein.
A sleeping pill which controls morning sickness in pregnant women administered?
Halidomide.
And phocomelia is the adverse effect of?
Halidomide.
Okay, which is a common neurotransmitter?
Acetylcholine.
The answer is all of the above. ये मैं अगले उसमें लूंगी. Actually मेरा जो एक presentation हुई थी नेहरू planetarium में, वहां पे मैंने discuss किया था. In fact, GABA and serotonin are also neurotransmitters. GABA is gamma amino butyric acid.
Serotonin also regulates something related to sleep.
Yes, actually GABA एक दवाई आती है GABA pentin के नाम से, और बहुत अगर तेज पेन हो ना, बहुत एक्सट्रीम पेन हो, इट इज यूज एज अ पेन किलर. GABA pentin इज अ पेन किलर. और ये क्या करता है, GABA is a neurotransmitter. So you feel pain only when from your head the messages, you know, suppose मेरी को उंगली में दर्द हो रहा है, तो उंगली से message brain में जा रहा है कि मुझे दर्द हो रहा है. But what GABA does is it just silences that transmission. So your brain will not realize that you are having pain. So that there is a medicine by the name of gabapentin which attacks the GABA amino acid. So all of them above are neurotransmitters, but yes, nerve agents ke liye acetylcholine is very important. Meena Mata was caused by
fish contaminated with mercury.
Okay, most toxic form of mercury is
organic mercury.
It is methyl mercury or ethyl mercury or any mercury. And organic mercury kya hota hai, usme kya hai specific?
Mam, us very type of
कार्बन और मर्करी के बीच में, ऑर्गेनिक मर्करी में देयर इज अ बॉन्ड बिटवीन कार्बन एंड मर्करी. द ट्रेजेडी एसोसिएटेड विद मिथाइल आइसोसाइनाइड,
भोपाल गैस ट्रेजेडी.
ओके, वेयर वाज द फर्स्ट मीनामाटा आउटब्रेक रिपोर्टेड? Kumamoto. Which is the following is the symptom?
ataxia, okay, not vomiting, ataxia,
numbness. जो लोग थे ना उन वो कुछ टाइम के बाद कुछ उठा भी नहीं पाते थे, उतने हाथ numb हो गए एकदम, ataxia. Who identified them? इसका आंसर मैंने नहीं बताया है, पर अगर तुम थोड़ा सा दिमाग लगाओ तो इसका आंसर खुद सोच के बता सकते हो. Who identified the mercury compound in shellfish?
First option.
प्रोफेसर एट द कुमामोटो यूनिवर्सिटी दैट वॉज डेलीगेटिंग इन टू द स्टडी ऑफ दिस. ऑफिशियल ओपिनियन ऑन मीनामाटा डिजीज वॉज अनाउंस्ड इन, ये मैंने नहीं बताया, रहने दो. Which factory was responsible for the outbreak of Minamata?
Shiso Minamata.
Okay, where was Chernobyl?
The USSR.
USSR तो इतना बड़ा हो गया. Ukraine. USSR तो पूरा country हो गई ना, बहुत बड़ी सी, पूरे USSR में नहीं, it was located in Ukraine. Okay, Minamata is an infectious disease. एक से दूसरे को हो सकता है छूने से, नहीं हो सकता ना,
बी फॉल्स बिकॉज इट कैन ओनली बी ट्रांसमिटेड
ओनली व्हेन यू ईट, ओनली व्हेन यू ईट द शेलफिश. विच ऑफ दीज वॉज नॉट अ कॉज ऑफ चेर्नोबिल?
Sabotage meant to weaken the USSR.
Sabotage meant to weaken the USSR.
Poorly designed reactor was a reason. Inadequate crew was the reason. Poor safety guidelines were a reason, but not any sabotage. How many people were killed in the explosion itself?
Two people were killed in the explosion.
31 firemen were killed, as you saw in that video. दो लोग तो साथ के साथ, जैसे ही फटा दो लोग मर गए. 31-32 लोग फायर फाइटर्स जो उसको आग को बुझाने आए वो इनहेल करके मरे. एंड देयर वर लाइक थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पीपल हु डाइड बिकॉज ऑफ थायराइड कैंसर. सो व्हेन डिड इट टेक प्लेस?
1986.
हाउ लॉन्ग डिड द फायर बर्न इन द कोर?
10 days. मैम जो वीडियो आपने दिखाया था मैम उसमें 15 डेज था.
तो फिर बेटा 15 मेरे ध्यान से 10 है, पर एक बार ही चेक कर लेना, ठीक है? As far as I remember, it's 10 days. Okay, what was the main reason for Chernobyl?
Flawed reactor design.
Mam, flawed reactor design.
Which of the following was dropped to extinguish?
Boron.
Dropped via a helicopter. Major health hazard from thyroid
cancer.
Thyroid cancer.
So with that, we come to the end. Very good. Very well performed, all of you.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, Prerna, over to you now. Finally. Yes. Very good. Very good. Big round of applause to all of you.
Yes. I think all are the budding chemists of the future. So, probably your lecture has aroused their interest in the chemistry as a subject. So, kudos to everyone. And really, all the best to everyone. And thank you, ma'am, for sharing such an interesting presentation. As I always say, your way of explaining things are in such an interesting manner that even though if you don't have a basic knowledge about the subject, still you are able to understand it. And the very beautifully you explain all the incidents, though they were very tragic. But yes. as you rightly quoted in your presentation ki itihas ko jaan ke hi hum apne future ko bana sakte hain,
issue ko samar sakte hain.
So all this information probably help us ki humne jo bhi galtiyan kari hain apne past mein hum wo aage na kare aur usko kaise behtar kar sake. So thank you, ma'am, for sharing all the information.
Absolutely, my pleasure. I am so happy to see the response from these students. Achyut, did you fill up the Google form last time? Did you get the Google link? You were very excited to fill up that form.
No, yes, ma'am. No, ma'am, I didn't got the email.
You didn't get the email?
We sent it.
Because I was looking up for your answer sheet, but I didn't find it. So, anyway, why don't you contact me?
Yes, ma'am, because I didn't got the email.
Yeah, you contact me on my number and then we can, I share you that link if at all you wish to. And thank you, students. Thank you all very much for such an overwhelming response and for such great enthusiasm. It's always great, a great experience to be amongst you all. Thank you all.
I want to acknowledge that the participation is very much improving, and the serious participation is there for all your lectures. So I really congratulate to all the participants who came here second time as well. So if you really wish to come for the next session that we will be having on 19th September, which is also a very interesting topic. I think somebody's mic is open. So you can write us at planetariumprogram@gmail.com, or either you can drop an email at planetarium@gmail.com if you wish to come for the session. So we will be sharing the login details there. So if you wish to come for the next session, that is on 9th September, Chemistry in Forensic Science. So with this note, thank you everyone for coming here. And also one request to everyone, if you can drop us feedback at nehruplanetarium@gmail.com. Aapke first session ka aur ye wale session ka, aapka jo bhi feedback hai, because I already shared email regarding that, but I think wo school mein gayi hogi email and probably they couldn't get back to...
Yes, I would appreciate that, students. Teaching learning process is a two-way process. Exactly. And aapko jitna achha lagta hai, appreciation paakar, utna hi motivation a teacher ko milta hai when he or she gets to know that whatever he or she was trying, you were able to get even 60 or 70% of it. It is very motivating. So it's, as I said, it's a two-way traffic. Agar response nahi aayega, it turns the teacher dead. So we would expect you to send responses, whatever it be. It may be good, it may be not good, but whatever it be, you must share your responses. You're old enough to voice out your opinions. Jahan nahi karna, wahan karte. Jahan bola jaye ki yahan apna opinion batao, wahan nahi karte, hai na bachcho? But anyway, thank you, Zaina. Thank you, Zaina, for your compliment. Thank you so much.
So I have dropped both the email IDs of Nehru Planetarium. If you can write us on any of the one regarding your feedback, as well as if you are interested to participate in a next session, which is on 19th September, Chemistry in Forensic Science. So we will be sharing details on the same email ID from which you'll write us. So on this note, thank you everyone for coming here, for being such an active and good participant. Thank you, Tripti ma'am, for delivering such an informative talk. And we really look forward for another exciting learning episode on 19th September. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.